talk about police violence and, yeah. and the trauma of that. And, mm-hmm. you know, I think that there's often been this idea, at least historically, that you have to experience trauma personally for it to count. But what do you think about police violence and all of these videos that are circulating all of the time and people having to watch murder on Twitter? And mm-hmm. What are your thoughts on that and what that's doing to our country and specifically, you know, Black Americans?
I feel like when I see that, whenever I see, you know, like recent media coverage about racial injustice, to me, I think of historical trauma mm-hmm. and I think of group trauma. And one thing we know quite clearly now is that, you know, generational trauma is a thing. You know, we inherit the trauma of our ancestors, not only psychologically and socially, you know, in the way that it impacts them and the way they raise us and their kind of behaviors, but also there's some early evidence to suggest that epigenetic mechanisms are at play too.
What's that?
So for example, this notion that, let's say if a woman experiences a trauma, she's impacted on a physiological level on a way that alters, you know, impacts her eggs. If a man experiences trauma, it impacts his sperm. So any subsequent children inherit these altered genetic profiles. They inherit the altered neuroanatomy and the neurobiology. And even though these children themselves may not have been experienced a trauma themselves, in the event that they do experience a trauma, they are responding with that inherited vulnerability. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know, so kind of early on in the science of epigenetics, but there is data to support this concept of generational trauma on a biological level. And that's what I think about when I see everything that's going on and I see the distress and the pain of the response, you know, across society, even though, like you say, you know, individuals themselves may not have been directly impacted, because this is a historical group trauma mm-hmm. that goes back centuries mm-hmm. and has not been fully addressed. And what has been missing? I mean, you know, we might have had some progress made in terms of civil rights or, you know, legal protections or political protections. What I think has been sorely missing throughout the centuries has been a very clear pathway for the psychological rehabilitation of trauma survivors so that they don't continue the cycle endlessly mm-hmm. throughout the generations. I think we're getting to that point now where we understand that PTSD is a thing, you know, and we want people to get help for it and treatment for it. But this is very recent. I mean, that's what's been missing, I think, the psychological rehabilitation. So those historical wounds, you know, I kind of call them soul wounds. They go back so deep. They need to be healed, you know, mm-hmm. before, you know, you can expect, you know, more peaceful resolution to these kind of ongoing injustices.
I mean, how can they? Like, I think truly it goes back to slavery for mm-hmm. Black people. And then mm-hmm. I think a lot about, I mean, Allison and I are both Jewish. I think the Holocaust has affected mm-hmm. our people intensely, mm-hmm. especially if you have grandparents or great grandparents who were in it, who were huge swaths of family who were just murdered. And so, like, how do you start to go back with someone, you know, I personally wasn't in the Holocaust, you know, mm-hmm. like someone who's watching this police brutality wasn't in slavery, but how do you start to like heal from that?
So, you know, I know it sounds really simple, but I think the fact that we're even having this conversation is huge. You know, I'm really a big believer in the name it's you can tame it philosophy. The reality is I think 20 years ago, we wouldn't be having this conversation. You know, we wouldn't be talking about generational trauma. You know, we would just be talking about that specific event in time. You know, we mm-hmm. wouldn't be talking. And, you know, and I do think there was this kind of overarching societal philosophy. Well, okay, you guys experienced that, but now you're in America, so you're all good now, you know, and that's in the past. And we don't talk about the past and we move forward. You know, there was this kind of stoicism that was more pervasive culturally or was more expected. I do think just having these conversations, just giving it a name, just being curious. Oh, okay. Is this why I'm this way? Because when my mom used to do this, or when my grandfather used to do this, this is how he would react. Have I on some level internalized that? Or what was the deeper meaning behind that? So I think having curiosity, having the conversations, and integrating that into our story moving forward, you know, I think these are all things that are different now in the conversations that we're having now that I honestly think just 10, 20 years ago, no one was open. It was just fringe people who were talking that way, mm-hmm. you know, no one was open to talking that way in the past. So I think just starting the conversation, just talking about it and increasing awareness, and then the trauma-informed stuff that we're talking about. You know, if all of us committed to be more trauma-informed in the way we lived our life, one thing we'd stop doing is re-traumatizing other people.
Yeah.
We'd all stop doing that. I mean, wouldn't that be a great start? If we just stopped re-traumatizing other people. And so, you know, the trauma-informed approaches, I think, are huge as well.
What's the difference between PTSD and complex PTSD? And why is it a little trickier to deal with complex PTSD?
So I think complex PTSD is kind of like a niche kind of diagnosis. It's not officially accepted by the big American Psychiatric Association. You know, it's not an official diagnosis, if you like. But there's a whole backstory to that. But it is a construct which I have found immensely valuable as a clinician. It was a term that was introduced by Dr. Judith Herman, who's this Harvard psychiatrist. And she introduced this as a syndrome to describe survivors of prolonged abuse, you know? So when we think of PTSD, like I say, a lot of it arose from watching soldiers who had survived wars, whether it was World War I, World War II, the Civil War, Vietnam. And typically the story there was you had someone who was going about their life, then bam, something really bad happened to them. And then they kind of went back to their regular life. So it's kind of like a singular, massively traumatic event. And what Dr. Herman was describing was, well, what do you do with people whose whole life has been abuse? Mm-hmm. You know, let's say mm-hmm. if they were sexually abused as children, neglected, emotionally abused, and that is all they have known. Or what do you do with survivors of intimate partner violence who have lived 20, 30 years in this kind of state of quote-unquote captivity? The symptoms of the PTSD look very different in survivors of prolonged trauma. There's a lot more deformations of kind of personality, because guess what? These people have had to learn to adapt to their circumstances. They have had to learn to survive next to the perpetrator, mm-hmm. you know? And so I think a lot of treatments that work for complex PTSD really have to address the interpersonal elements and the personality elements. And then a lot of times the emotional dysregulation that comes with that. And that's what makes it a little bit more complicated.
Because you're not just doing that exposure to one incident, because there's so many things that have happened.
So where do you start?
Right.
And it's so entrenched. And definitely in the case of childhood abuse, you're experiencing abuse before you even got to form a proper personality. So where is your before and after, mm-hmm. you know? So it can be incredibly challenging, yeah.
What about right now with collective trauma that everyone is going through with the pandemic? I saw some news footage from March 2020 and I was like, wanted to throw up. It reminded me of when the pandemic was starting and I remembered the fear from that. And I was like, oh my, I just felt awful seeing triggered. The news footage. Yeah. And I wondered if as like a 60-year-old, my kid is going to be studying the pandemic and I'm going to be like, don't bring that near me, you know?
Yeah. I do think, I mean, obviously I was a PTSD specialist before this pandemic, but having lived through it with, you know, forever a year, I'm really concerned. I feel like there are going to be massive swaths of people who have got major trauma related to the pandemic. You know, when I think of all the people who survived COVID, you know, I mean, obviously there's the awful numbers of people who died, but there are massive chunks of people who had a near-death experience, but they survived it. When I think of them, when I think of people who lost loved ones under sudden and horrific circumstances, never got to have a proper burial, never got to go through all those healing rituals. When I think of frontline healthcare professionals, the people working in the ERs, the ICUs, the janitors cleaning the hallways, the nursing aides, everybody. And then when I also think of essential workers, right? The people who had to keep the grocery stores open, had to deliver our packages throughout the quarantine. I just think you have millions of people who are living with, and I bet they haven't even begun to process the trauma yet, because we're not done with it yet, right? Mm-hmm. We're not through it yet. So I think it's going to be fascinating how it plays out. Now, we are at this moment in history where we know a lot about PTSD. PTSD has become part of our modern vernacular, you know, in the post 9/11 era. So maybe we'll go about it in a better way. Maybe you won't be, you know, the grandma who locked it away and didn't talk about it and spent her whole life. You know, maybe you'll be curious. Maybe you'll recognize where you're in trouble and get help so that you can tell this integrated narrative to your grandchildren in a way that is more, you know, healed, as opposed to something that is, has cast this longitudinal shadow, you know, over your life. So it's going to play it out in the weeks and months and years, but I'm very worried in terms of post-traumatic, you know, after the pandemic. I'm very concerned. You know, I think we haven't even begun to see the psychological consequences.
And for people who think, well, no one I love died, or and considering what happened, what I went through wasn't that bad. Like, what would you say to that? Is it still possible that they're going to have symptoms just by going through this collective experience?
You know, there were many traumas. And again, like I said, there's trauma with the big T, there's trauma with the little T. There's a lot of, you know, losses, a lot of loss of rites of passage, a lot of loss of losing, you know, kind of conventional access to community. I think it just depends. It's hard for me to imagine people getting out of this totally unscathed, right? You know? And if you did, you're a very, very, very lucky person. Then you might want to think about giving back in other ways then, you know? But I don't know, as it marches on, don't you feel, you know, more and more people who've been impacted by this? I do. I just feel like, you know, it's starting to really take its toll in so many ways on so many people.